Hi, I'm Jamie. Welcome back to my YouTube channel about Sjogren's and autoimmune diseases. And today I want to talk about the difficulty of getting a diagnosis for specifically Sjogren's disease. But some of this content will be helpful for many other autoimmune diseases that also may be difficult. For Sjogren's disease specifically, the average diagnosis is 3.5 years. Just seems outrageous to me because I was diagnosed first try from my doctor, not even my rheumatologist. And I had conflicting testing that I'm going to talk to you about. But one of the reasons I really, really want to make this huge recommendation, one of the biggest reasons it's hard to get a diagnosis, which is really not the fault of ours or our doctors, is that Sjogren's patients and many autoimmunes, we have over 40 different ailments and symptoms. So what we tend to do is go to the doctor for sort of isolated symptoms. So I've went to the doctor, I don't know how many times, for how many different ailments. First of all, I've seen a dentist probably 10 times more than the average person that I know. I mean, I spent so much money trying to save my teeth, and I was just told it was genetic, bad teeth are genetic. I've been to the doctor for rashes on my body. Well, that could be 100 different reasons why you need to go see a dermatologist. I had premature babies. Well, there's 100 reasons why. Heavy periods and frequent urination. Yeah, you know, it's common. This kind of stuff is common. I had went to the doctor for shoulder and neck pain. Oh, probably because you're a professional photographer. You know, you're going to experience pain. Maybe you have bone spurs. I've been to chiropractors. Let me tell you, when I was diagnosed, I had never heard of Sjogren's. I got in my car and I read dry eye, dry mouth, and I thought, what's the big deal? When I started reading and researching more, I immediately made a list of my symptoms. I had 22 symptoms. I have more than that now over time, that my symptoms have, some of them have progressed, some new ones, some ones that I've realized over time. So anyway, my suggestion, write down all of your symptoms and ailments at once and take them to the doctor, show them to your rheumatologist. That will help significantly to try to help you get a correct diagnosis. If you have already done that, you might be in this predicament, like so many, that you got a negative ANA. And so an ANA is a blood test that will tell you if you have any kind of autoimmune disease. I want to tell you, my first ANA came back positive just from my doctor, and my antibodies for Sjogren's popped. And so I got an immediate diagnosis. However, when I went to the rheumatologist, my ANA came out negative. I mean, who knew? Yet my SSA antibodies were really high. So antibodies, how do you let me kind of read you for a second. So SSA and SSB are the two antibodies that you would be tested for Sjogren's. Just so you know, only 60 to 80% will test positive for your SSA. And SSB is a lot more uncommon. It's 30 to 50%. Typically, SSA antibodies are going to be only Sjogren's disease, where SSB could be other diseases combined. So, by the way, I'm not a doctor, so if I get anything wrong, bear with me. I'm just trying to learn like the rest of you. A lot of my information I'm getting out of the Sjogren's book, edition 5, lots of different doctors and rheumatologists and articles and research studies and that sort of thing. So I'm trying to do my best, just like you. Your antibodies, it's a group of proteins in the blood, and they bind to molecular targets. So that could be microorganisms, cells, blood proteins. So this is specific to Sjogren's. So you could have a negative ANA, but then if your antibodies are positive, then it means you have Sjogren's. However, you can get false negatives for your ANAs, and your antibodies may not show up as positive. So, and you might not get a number. So then what? So then most of the time what they're going to do is a lip biopsy, and they're going to make an incision and take out like 5 different little spots for your salivary glands to do salivary gland testing. This isn't fun. Some people opt to do this, some people don't. Sometimes you're going to get a diagnosis with family history, a list of your ailments. There's other diagnostic tests. Let me see. There's abnormal salivary gland ultrasonograph, whatever that is. Anti-nuclear antibody test. If you have a positive rheumatoid factor. So there's other ways to get a diagnosis, but you know, this can be make it very difficult when up to 40% of patients can't get a positive ANA or antibody. It's like, and then just doctors don't believe you, right? So this is another problem with getting the correct diagnosis, is most doctors don't even know what Sjogren's is. They really don't. They don't know anything about it. In fact, I think a lot of them Google search before they even walk into the office, because so many people in my group, like so many people, the doctors are like, oh, it's no big deal. It's just dry mouth, dry eyes. Well, no, it's not. It's a systemic disease that infects your entire body, everything about your body. I'm going to actually do a YouTube on that, because it's significant that it affects your memory, your heart, your lungs. It can affect your kidneys. Your endocrine system, just every single part of your body can be affected by Sjogren's. So remember that it's not just dry eyes, dry mouth. It's not in your head. Just because people can't see your disease doesn't mean that you're not suffering from it. And just because you can't get a doctor to listen to you, keep trying to find doctors. And that's the next point I want to make, is rheumatologists are scarce. We need more rheumatologists in America. I know in the Pacific Northwest, it can take up to a year to get into a rheumatologist. And that's if you can get a diagnosis from your doctor and if your insurance will say yes. So you could be sitting there waiting, and then you could get in to see your rheumatologist, and then they're going to make you test. And then it could be another 3 months or 6 months for that follow-up appointment to even get the results. And then if there's negative, then what do you do? Then what do? Then you have to beg for a biopsy or go through something a little bit more grueling. And I mean, this is, you could see how the testing could take so long. You get the testing, the results, then you got to have an appointment to talk over the testing and blah, 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 blah. So it's important that you're your own advocate. It's important that, you know, these people behind the phone are just people. So it's important to be persistent. It's important to be proactive. It's important to do your own research, your own reading in your own city if you're capable. If not, ask a family member, because I know it can affect retention and memory and that sort of thing. So it's really important to sort of write down everything you can and grab from whatever you can. And I'm so sorry. I'm just one of the lucky ones that guy got diagnosed, although I have had rheumatologists question my diagnosis, which is crazy. I mean, the blood says it, everything about me. I have so many ailments, and then they still question it. So, not all medical professionals will even agree with all the ailments of Sjogren's. One, it's understudied. All the study goes to lupus. Lupus has been around a lot longer than Sjogren's. Sjogren's is sort of a newer autoimmune disease. So it's so misunderstood, and it's also not understood. There's so much that's like hypothesized and lumped into lupus, and well, we think, and it could be this, and we're pretty sure this, but not a lot of facts. And the facts that like are in this book, for example, are extremely difficult to understand. And most doctors aren't gonna take the time, even rheumatologists. If you've got an older rheumatologist, he may not know that as much about Sjogren's, right? I mean, he's gonna know a lot about rheumatoid arthritis, gonna know a lot about lupus and that sort of thing, but maybe not as much about Sjogren's. So sometimes we're gonna have to either fire our doctor, rheumatologist. It's almost impossible to fire a rheumatologist, because where are you gonna get another one? How are you gonna get into another one? A lot of them don't even take new patients. And like I said, that 6 month to 1 year waiting list sucks. So it could just be grueling. And why is a diagnosis so important? Because without a diagnosis, how are you getting the care you need? How are you getting doctors to take you serious? How are you getting the correct medicine? And is your insurance going to give you hydroxychloroquine? Are they going to say, yeah, if you don't have a diagnosis? Most of the time, it's hard to justify medications without a diagnosis. So I hope this was helpful for any of you. And just know we understand, and you can get a diagnosis without positive ANA and antibodies. So talk to your doctor and rheumatologist about some of these things we discussed, and look up the lip biopsy. Oh gosh, what's it called? Ooh, it's called a minor LSG biopsy, which it does suck. I'm not gonna lie, it's painful and it can make your lips swell and it sucks. But So anyhow, keep trying to get that diagnosis. We know how important that diagnosis is. If you can find a doctor that will listen to you. If your doctor dismisses Sjogren's as an option, if your doctor downplays Sjogren's or scoffs at you, get a new doctor. Do not mess around. I have an amazing doctor. It took me a long time to find him. Fire your doctor. Get a new doctor if they're not listening to you. Fight for yourself as a patient. And I just really good luck to all of you out there. And we're going to keep on keeping on. Good luck.